Today, right after the service, we invite you to support our youth by coming downstairs to the chili dinner. You can enjoy a great lunch and help them raise funds for their upcoming activities. The church council will eat at the chili dinner, then move to another area for their meeting. The children will eat at the chili dinner, then move upstairs to practice on their Christmas musical. Coming up this Saturday, November 12th, the monthly bread shed will be held at First Baptist Church. We will set up the leftover coats from our drive to give away at this time. We could use your help with this distribution. I want to remind you to put Sunday night, November 20th, on your calendar for the annual Celebration of Thanksgiving at 6 o'clock. We'll have a potluck dinner, then share some things we are thankful for before watching a video of the past year's activities here at Grace. Then all who can help will move upstairs to decorate for Christmas. Awesome fun night at GCF. Please stand as we join together for worship.
Yeah. joy, perfect peace, and earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive, and He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day, 'cause You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day, 'cause You washed my sin away.
Praise that You're due. The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. the Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon Him. One final breath He gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, a war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake. The stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified.
Hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. There are words for him, then I don't have them. You see, my brain has not yet reached a point where it could form a thought that could adequately describe the greatness of my God. And my lungs have not yet developed the ability to release a breath with enough agility to breathe out the greatness of his love. And my voice is so inhibited, restrained by human limits, that it's hard to even send a praise up, you see. If there are words for him, then I don't have them. My God, his grace is remarkable. Mercies are innumerable. Strength is impenetrable. He is honorable, accountable, and favorable. Unsearchable yet knowable. Indefinable yet approachable. Indescribable yet personal. He is beyond comprehension, further than imagination, constant through generations, King of every nation. Amen. But if there are words for him, then I don't have them. You see, my words are few. And to try to capture the one true God using my vocabulary will never do. But I use words as an expression to a Savior. A Savior who is both worthy and deserving of my praise. So I use words. My heart extols the Lord, blesses his name forever. He has won my heart, captured my mind, and has bound them both together.
Thank you.
He has defeated me in my rebellion, conquered me in my sin. He has welcomed me into his presence, completely invited me in. He has made himself the object of my sight, flooding me with mercies in the morning, drowning me with grace in the night. But if there are words for him, then I don't have them. But what I do have is good news. For my God knew that man-made words would never do. For words are just tools that we use to point to the truth. So he sent his son, Jesus Christ, as the word, living proof. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, giving nothingness formation. And by his word he sustains in the power of his name. For he is before all things, and over all things he reigns. Holy is his name, so praise him for his life.
Thank you, Jesus.
the way he persevered in strife, the humble Son of God becoming the perfect sacrifice. Praise him for his death. That he willingly stood in our place, that he lovingly endured the grave, that he battled our enemy, and on the third day rose in victory. He is everything that was promised. Praise him as the risen King. Lift your voice and sing. For one day he will return for us, and we will finally be united with our Savior for eternity. Eternity. So it's not just words that I proclaim, for my words point to the Word, and the Word has a name. Hope has a name. Joy has a name. Peace has a name. Love has a name. And that name is Jesus Christ. Praise his name forever.
are holy. One day every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that you are Lord.
Amen.
And Lord, we choose today to bow our knee. We choose today to confess, not to wait to the end. We choose today to confess that you are Lord. You are the King. You are the first and you are the last. There is nobody higher. There is nobody wiser. There is nobody but you, Lord. We honor you, God. We honor you. We lift you up because you're worthy of praise. You're worthy of honor and you're worthy of our glory. We honor you today, God. We say hallelujah. We say hallelujah to you, Father. Which means we praise you, God, with everything within us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. We worship you, Jesus.
Continue the prayer time right now, but I want to make this plea to come and pray for our election. We need to be praying. We need to be praying for our country. We need to be praying for those who are currently in power and those who will become in power, will come in power as a result of the election. We just need to be praying for our country. And so if you've got a specific prayer request, the prayer team is up here to pray with you, but I also want to invite just come and to kneel at the altar and intercede for our country, okay? Because it's only prayer, the power of prayer and faith in God Almighty, it's going to have any effect upon this country. It's good. Amen. Our faith is not in government. Amen. Our faith is not in politicians. Our faith is not in the economy. Our faith is in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and God Almighty. So I invite you to come intercede for our country as we sing.
Nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Thank you, Jesus. Your presence. Thank you for your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free. My shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. We lift our praise to you, God.
Thank you. You sing all around, but I never hear the sound. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. And Lord, I'm amazed by you.
Bye.
Sometimes it's easy to get captivated by the things of this world, and our flesh becomes amazed with the temporary stuff. And then when it's all said and done, we're disappointed and we're let down and we're just defeated because we focused on the wrong thing. Father, I thank you so much that you've told us in your word how great and mighty you are, and our focus is upon you. That's what our faith is supposed to be all about, is be amazed by you. And every time we look to you, we feel like Isaiah, and we almost feel like saying, oh, woe is me, when we feel the power of your presence and the awesomeness of you being here, being with us, being near, being closer than a brother, closer than our very breath even. So Father, we thank you for your presence here. Continue to move among us. And we do, Father, lift up our country before you. We lift up our community, we lift up our state, we lift up our country. As we enter into this election in 2 days, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will help us to vote according to your word, according to your values, according to what would be best to reflect our love of God Almighty. Help us not be caught up in the political mumbo jumbo. Help us not to be caught up in things that we shouldn't be caught up in. Help us not vote according to party. Help us not vote according to because somebody else is voting a certain way. Help us to search our hearts. Search our hearts and a vote according to your principles, oh God. And help us, Lord, as important as that vote is, and we should, Lord, I believe, thank you for the honor and the privilege it is to live in a country where our country is dependent upon the vote of the people. We know things aren't going real well right now, and that's because of the way we voted. But God, our faith is not in our government, not in our way of government. God, our faith and our trust is solidly in you, God. Help us to be diligent in praying for our country like you've exhorted us to do in your word. It's merely obedience to pray for our country. So help us to be obedient and not disobedient in doing that. We thank you, God, that you love us. You love us so much that you gave your only Son, that whosoever believes in you should never perish, but have everlasting life. It's the greatest of all truths in the universe. And we focus upon that and that alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. My batteries are gone. There's batteries down there. They're coming. Change me out, brother. I'm bionic man. I have battery. I can't run without batteries, right? Praise God. I'm wasting time while he does this. How's everybody today? All right. Praise God. Praise God. While we do this, am I on?
Am I on now? Oh, I am so on. I've never been more on in my life. Okay. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm going to call the ushers down at this time to receive tithes and offerings. I'm going to be preaching, not today, but starting next Sunday, at least one message, maybe two, on the absolute importance of giving to God. Okay? Now, it's going to be a stewardship thing, and all the blessings that are associated with that. But we're gonna take a look at that, okay? Because it's important for us, no matter how young we are in the Lord, or how many, or whether we've walked with God for a long time, it is a critical aspect of our Christian life. And sometimes we don't put the weight on it that we should, okay? And because it's a spirit thing, it's a soul thing, it's not just a material thing. You hear what I'm saying? Because it all starts from in here. And so as we give to God, let's just know that you can't outgive him. Anybody ever outgiven God? Didn't think so. Me neither, okay? You can't outgive God, so let's give to him, the giving God of the universe.
Heavenly Father, I just want to say thank you for this morning, Lord, and thank you for this worship service. And Lord, I thank you for pouring your spirit upon each and every one of us this morning, Lord. And I thank you for your blessings in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, children, come on down. I'll meet with you down here. And you are the winner because you sit right up front. Praise the Lord. All right, praise God, praise God. Come on over real close. Whoa, that's pretty close. Praise God, praise God. Come on over close, come on over close. All right, praise the Lord. All right, well, you all are working on a Christmas musical, aren't you? Already? Already? Yeah, but you know, it takes a long time to work on that, right? Y'all focus up here. Look at me. Look at my eyes. See my eyes? Okay. Now, you're working on a Christmas musical, right? That's because, you know why we do that? We focus up on that and put so much work into it? It's because the coming of Jesus is the most important thing that has ever happened in the history of the universe.
What?
Yes.
What?
That's right. The most important thing. And that's why Christmas is so important. Christmas and Easter. Because that is the two things that help us to remember that Jesus is more important than anything else. Y'all believe that? That's more important than anybody, anything else. He's more important than anybody else. And so it helps us to, every year, it comes around Christmas time, and I know we like all the presents and gifts, and why am I talking about Christmas before Thanksgiving? Because I know you're already working on it, okay? I just want to say that Jesus Christ is the focus of all of our life, okay? All right, can you all bow your heads and close your eyes? All right. Lord Jesus, I ask your blessing upon these children. What a special blessing they are. And Father, I thank you as you bless the children of old, I bless them now in the name of Jesus. And bless them, and I call forth the gifts of and the callings of pastors, preachers, teachers, evangelists, missionaries, Christian pilots, Christian businessmen and women, Christian moms and dads, and there's so many other things, Father, that you've called them. I call forth the wonderful gifts that are in them too. And I thank you for each and every one, Lord. They're so special in your sight. Lead them and guide them and bless all those that work with them every week, Father. It just proves how much we love them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, you can go downstairs. I did. Well, hallelujah, hallelujah. So, Tuesday's election day. It's a critical time in the history of the United States. I'm not going to preach a political sermon today, but my subject matter has everything to do with our country, because it's about, we're going to be talking about faith, and what kind of faith is God going to find, is Jesus going to find when he finally returns back to this earth, okay? And it's an interesting question that Jesus asked, but it is related to the condition of our country. I do want to draw your attention one more time to the table over here that has some handouts for you. And if you haven't been here in previous Sundays, you haven't heard me say this, but And just to remind us all that we need to vote as intelligently as we possibly can, be as informed as we possibly can. Now, I know there's a lot of information out there, and it's hard to get it all in, okay? It really is. So you just do your best and let God do the rest, and vote according to biblical principles. Specifically, we've got sheets over here that compare the candidates and where they stand on values that are important to Christians and just values, period, okay? And so that's why the charts are over there, the comparisons. And we vote for the candidate that lines up closest to the biblical mandates, okay? There has never, ever been a perfect candidate. Never, ever. This year, especially so. And I'm saying that very kindly. But anyway, we do need to vote, though, and I really do encourage that. There's some extra handouts over there, though. Let me tell you about those real quickly. First of all, there's a ballot measure sheet, and they were all gone. I made more copies. If you picked up a ballot measure sheet last week, talking about the six different things, there is a supplement over there. And it's a sheet right next to it. You'll see them all in the same little stack thing. But it's a supplement explaining about Amendment 3. Amendment 3 has shown itself to be a very confusing thing, okay? And so that little addendum there, it's a supplement, helps to, I just wrote that just to bring a little bit of clarity, a little bit, anyway, and encourage you to do your own research. And right next to that is how the Concerned Women for America are encouraging votes, or they're recommending votes on those particular things. The Christian Women for America is headed up, the national organization headed up by Beverly LaHaye, the wife of Tim LaHaye, one of the co-authors, him with Jerry B. Jenkins, wrote the Left Behind series books, and there's been movies and all that kind of stuff. It's his wife. And she heads that up, and it's a very Christian organization. They have a legal team. Anyway, they have their recommendations there. Again, their recommendations. We're not telling anybody how to vote, but vote according to biblical principle as close as we can. And some of those, it's just hard to understand, okay? So you just really pray and do your best and let God do the rest, as we say around our house. Okay, so we got that. And then there's an article on the far end. There's two articles. There's one that we've had out there for a while. It's called Between a Rock and a Hard Place, I think, or something like that. But there's another one, a new one I put out by Dutch Sheets. It's called Election 2016, The Christian's Dilemma. Pretty well sums it up, doesn't it? The Christian's Dilemma, okay? And they're handouts, and it's his viewpoint of how to look at this election, so I encourage you to get those too, okay? All right, that's done. Now, over against the far wall, you'll see the orange sign that says Free. Okay, there are some pictures there. I went through my office and I cleaned out my office. Well, I'm in the process. It's going to take a while. But I had a lot of pictures I had printed up and had stacked and everything. And I've taken out all those pictures. And some of them I've entered into photo contests. And others are just printed off thinking I might enter it. You know, you print off the maybes too. But anyway, they're over there. And some have already picked through them. But I want you to feel free to take them. There's no charge. Just take them. Maybe an early Christmas gift. You get one, buy a frame. Christmas gift for somebody. Who knows, you know. But anyway, feel free to take what you want there, okay? And I'll leave it up until they're all gone, or if it comes down to two or three, I'll just take care of it, okay? Also, we want to share about the miracle of Jeremiah Suter. Did we share this last Sunday? Jeremiah? Okay, we prayed. The Suters used to go to church here, and Jeremiah was sick and in the hospital. He was having seizures, was out cold for a day at least, I think, 12 hours. And they were really worried, and come to find out, it was I won't explain all that. But anyway, God healed him. It's a miracle. Yes, amen. God healed him. We just need to give God praise. And several in this church were in touch with them and praying for them. And we did it at a tailgate party. It's amazing what happens at a tailgate party. We prayed for healing. Yes, and Sylvia, yeah, and we'll continue to pray for Sylvia. I've given reports on Wednesday night, but she is coming along good, but continue to pray. Yeah, and rehab here. So continue to pray for her. That's a long process when you have brain surgery. And it's a very serious thing. So let's be sure to keep that in mind, okay? All right, turn with me, if you would, to Luke chapter 18. The title of the message is Good Question, Jesus. God asks questions. And as you know, I've mentioned this before, but God does ask questions throughout the Bible. If you it's a fun topic sometimes if you're for your Bible study time, for your quiet time, go through the Bible and see how many questions God asks. God asks a lot of questions. And it didn't stop when Jesus came on board. Jesus asked questions too, and this is one of those questions that Jesus asked. And so leave it to Jesus to ask a question that shakes you to your core. Very profound, simple but profound question that he asked here. And in fact, you know, when I have a whole sermon series on questions that God asks, and I may at some time bring it out and dust it off, but because it's one of those sermon series that really helps to get to the heart of the matter. You know, he has all the answers already. We already know that. That's not a question. He didn't ask questions because he needs more information. He knows it all. He's the original know-it-all and the only know-it-all. Really, okay? And he has all the answers, right? So he is obviously wanting something else. He wants us to delve deep inside ourselves and do some self-examination of some kind. That's why he asks questions, is there's nothing like a question to get somebody's attention. You know, I took a little advertising course when I was in college in my telecommunications degree studies, and one of those things, a question gets attention. You know, start out a newspaper article or magazine article or a sermon series or a sermon, you know, a question always kind of helps grab your attention. Oh, I wonder. Well, here's Jesus doing this. And in this case, in Luke, there is one point he is wanting us to get. But in order to do this, there are some important pieces of this puzzle we've got to discover. So let's look at Luke chapter 18, and we'll get to the question. It's verses 1 through 8. Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. So there is no question what this parable is about. Jesus, right up front with his disciples, right up front with us, here's the point, before he even tells the parable. He said, in a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared about men. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, grant me justice against my adversary. For some time he refused, but finally he said to himself, even though I don't fear God or care about men, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice so she won't eventually wear me out with her coming. And the Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? I know a lot of you have read that scripture before and you kind of wonder, it's a good question, but it seems a bit out of place here. You know, all of a sudden he asks that question. What's that got to do with, you know, anything? And it has everything to do with the context, all right? This question is asked in the context of a parable on prayer. First and foremost, don't miss that. That's probably the most obvious point, but it's in the context of prayer. Jesus begins the parable of the persistent widow by explaining up front what the parable is about, so there's no question about what the point was, okay? Now, the point of the parable is persistent prayer. Persistent prayer. Don't get sidetracked with the idea of an unjust judge and comparing him to God. I know a lot of people said, well, that's God, he's unjust, he doesn't like man, blah, 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 all this. Don't even go there. A lot of times parables and stories, there's two main ways these are communicated. One is by comparison and the other is by contrast. Guess what category this one falls in? Contrast, okay? It's to get a point across, all right? That if an unjust judge can get a heart where he finally gives in, how much more will a loving God, and we're saying, you know, we're persistent in our prayers and we're asking God for this, and we keep coming to him. God has compassion for us. And he is not an unjust judge. The Heavenly Father wants to honor our persistent prayer request. And so it's about persistent prayer. So to answer the question of whether Jesus will find faith on the earth has something to do with very determined, persistent, tenacious prayer. Now, I know over the years I've heard it said, and I kind of thought this myself from time to time. I said, well, if God heard you the first time, why do you need to pray again about the same thing? You know, kind of makes sense, right? God doesn't forget. He doesn't forget stuff, okay? I do, right, Pam? Okay, amen. But God doesn't forget things. So if you pray once, he hears it, and is he going to remember it? Well, of course he does. But that's not the issue here. The issue, the focus is not upon God and God remembering prayer and our persistent, you know, persistently pulling on his robe like a kid, you know, teasing for candy at the candy store. God wants us to be tenacious in our prayers. He wants us to come to him, and it's okay to pray about the same thing over and over again. Now, there might possibly come a time when God says, okay, you can stop now. But He loves it when we come to him, because what that says to him is that we believe and trust that he's the one that's got the answer. Nobody else. I keep coming to you, God, because nobody else can do this. Nobody else has the answer. Nobody else can figure this thing out but you. And so that's evidence of trust. It's evidence of trust. So it's about persistent, determined, tenacious prayer. Secondly, the bigger picture is that this question is being asked during a discourse on the second coming of Jesus Christ. We may miss that, because if you start in chapter 18, nice clean starting point when you're reading scripture, we may not notice that it's really a carryover from chapter 17. Because chapter 17 is talking about the coming of the kingdom of God. All right? Now, the first part of chapter 18 is a carryover. Chapter 17, Jesus is teaching about the kingdom of God and its relation to his future return. Now, Jesus is saying that there are two aspects of the kingdom. Now, hang in there, because this will all come together. The one that is actually within those who have placed their faith in Jesus, the Messiah, Savior, and Lord, as Savior and Lord, okay? The kingdom of God, he says, the kingdom of God is within you. He starts out with that. But then he goes on to talk about the external evidence of that internal truth. External evidence of the internal truth for all God's people. And it says the external evidence of the consummation or the fulfillment or the completion of all that that means when Jesus returns to this earth proclaiming eternal victory. You know, if you read your Bible much, you know he's going to come back riding on a white horse, right? And we're all going to be behind him. And I got all that victory stuff going on. All right, so that's kingdom, that's part of the kingdom as well. So it says in Luke 18:21, the kingdom of God is within you. And then in 18:30 it says it will be just like this on the day the Son of Man returns. Talking about the conditions. There is a coming a day that Jesus will be revealed to all humankind, past and present, when it will become obvious to all what the kingdom of God is really all about. The kingdom of God is within you, but the kingdom of God is also expressed outwardly as well. So let's not miss this, the kingdom of God, and that's the bigger context. Now, in the midst of extremely tough conditions in the end times, where will our faith be? That's really the question.
That's what Jesus is trying to get across. He's putting it in context here. In the midst of extremely tough conditions in the end times, where will our faith be? Now, do you believe we're in pretty challenging times? Anybody not agree with that? Okay. Now, there's been periods of really hard times throughout history and everything, but in the United States, we've had relatively smooth ride. We really have. I mean, since the founding of our country and everything, and I know there was an American Revolution and all that kind of stuff, and yeah, there were some rough places, but God has blessed us. And we have a really a neat country that we have been blessed with. But things are kind of turning. If you're a Christian, and people know it, you become the odd guy or the odd lady out. You know, I'm talking about in terms of the world. I'm talking about the terms of the conditions that are in the United States of America. And Christians are starting to be specifically separated out and persecuted. Separated out. I've given examples over the years. I'm not going to go into those again. But just know that's the kind of world we live in here in America. And it's really going, you know, a lot of places all over the world. Now, so what are some of these conditions? Well, that's one of them. Another one is radical Islam. Radical Islam. I'm going to say a bold statement here. We are to love the Islamic people. But Islam is anything but a peaceful religion. It is anything but a peaceful religion. Radical Islam is getting much more press, positive press, than Christianity nowadays. That there's sexual promiscuity that's just going on everywhere. I got an article on my desk that I pulled off the internet a couple weeks ago, and the article is Cohabitation New Normal. Cohabitation, living together before you're married. That has become the new normal. Now, normal is in quotes. It's normal for the world, but not normal for Christ. Not normal for Christians. Not normal for what the Bible says we're supposed to be doing or not doing. It's still against Scripture, but it has become, in our society, become accepted now. And God hasn't changed his mind on that. That falls under the category of sexual promiscuity, along with a lot of other things, but I'm going to go into those. You can fill in the blanks there. Another evidence of the tough times that we're living in is that government is trying to dictate what we can or can't believe and practice. And it's becoming more and more of a reality. Trying to tell us what we can believe, what we can't believe, and where we can practice it. You know, the saying now is, oh, Christians, you can practice your beliefs within the four walls of a church, but don't dare to live your Christianity outside. You can't do it in the public realm anymore because it will offend people. Do you know Jesus brought offense? Jesus brought offense, not because he wanted to, but just because following Jesus and following the Scripture is offensive to some people that aren't walking with God. If you're not walking with Jesus, it's offensive. It really is. In fact, the Bible talks about that being offensive. So we need to walk our walk. We need to live our life in spite of how our country's going, in spite of how mixed up and screwed up, okay, the government is. We need to be living our lives for Jesus. And someone said, well, what should we do in response to this whole thing? Live your life for Jesus. Nothing has changed. Nothing has changed except, well, you may want to live more forcefully, you know, more intentionally, more, you know, like make up your mind kind of thing, okay? And that's, how about that? That's kind of what we're talking about here, all right? Now, also, another evidence, okay, the homosexual movement, we all know about that. Christianity is now considered dangerous. If you love Jesus, you're dangerous. Amen. You're dangerous. Yeah. Dangerous to the devil, I hope. I hope he runs scared when he sees you coming, or me coming, or his demons. You know the story, you know, about the demons are, saw somebody wake up and said, oh no, he's up. You run scared because you get out of bed in the morning. I hope we're living our lives like that. That's the way it's supposed to be. You know, we're not supposed to be compromised and fit into the culture and try to look like everybody else. No, Jesus didn't do that. Jesus didn't do that. He was the odd man out. But he did it for a righteous reason. He was calling people to get their focus upon a kingdom that was not of this world. This world isn't the focus. I mean, I thank God for our playthings and the houses and nice stuff, the TVs and all that kind of stuff. But folks, those are material possessions. Material possessions. God has called us to keep our eyes upon the better, the kingdom, the spiritual kingdom. Jesus never claimed the people wanted to make him the king here, over this world, over this earth. But Jesus refused. He refused because his kingdom was not of this world. Kingdom of God, a spiritual kingdom. It always has been, always will be. Let's look at the question one more time. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? I wanted to find the word faith. Now I know this is like Christianity 101, right? Faith. I know what faith is. Okay, faith. If we don't understand faith, then we won't understand Scripture. We got to get the faith right. It's a basic. It's a foundational belief, foundational doctrine. Oh, he said doctrine from the pulpit. Yes. Believing something means you have a doctrine about it, okay? We'll go that with another thing. Anytime you look at a scripture and you define it and you say, well, this is what that means. Well, you've just done a doctrine. Shame on you. Anyway, here the word faith is very common, obviously, and used throughout the New Testament and means a trust and confidence that manifests itself in obedience and faithfulness. That's from cover to cover what faith means. I'm going to say it again. It's a trust. Faith is a trust and confidence that manifests itself. In other words, it becomes real and is seen in obedience and faithfulness. It's not sitting like a bump on a log and believing that God exists somewhere. That's a little belief, maybe. But it's not biblical faith. Biblical faith has obedience and faithfulness attached to it. It's not real biblical faith unless we're living the life. You hear what I'm saying? We got to be living it. Or our faith is just words. It's not real faith. So putting it all together, when we look at verses 7 and 8, Jesus says, and will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones? And when it says chosen ones, your translation may say elect, or it's really meaning believers, true believers, who cry out to him day and night. Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. Now, this implies that things are going to get so difficult, there will be conditions that God's saints will endure that justice, vindication will have to be done. You know, we can look around and say, oh yeah, it's getting bad. Well, you haven't seen anything yet. That's why this sermon is necessary. That's why this message from God's word is necessary, to get us prepared, because things are going to get a whole lot tougher than they are right now. Right now, still a relative piece of cake, but it's going to get harder. It's going to get harder. And folks, we need to get tough. Get tough with Jesus. Okay, with ourselves and walking with Jesus. Things are going to be so difficult that there will be conditions that God's saints will endure, that justice and vindication will have to be done. What kind of circumstances are we talking about? Persecutions, slander, mistreatment, abuse, rejection, extreme prejudice, etc., etc., etc. I praise God. I've said this before, I'm going to say it again. I praise God for Poplar Bluff in Southeast Missouri. We're still in a relatively protected pocket here, but it's beginning to creep in, this persecution thing, and, you know, trying to
please everybody, and when you try to do that, you please nobody, okay? And but we're still relatively protected around here, and I praise God for that. Keep praying, keep praying, keep praying. But don't be surprised when it hits, when it creeps in. It probably won't hit all of a sudden. It'll probably just work its way in. So pay attention to what your kids are studying in school. Pay attention to local news items and different things that are going on, like in city and council, city council, government, city government, county government, state government, and all that kind of stuff. Because those are signs of things that are changing. So putting all this together, Jesus is asking if when he returns, will he find Christians with a strong enough faith to remain faithful and obedient, even though we are being persecuted, even though we're being ridiculed, even though we're being slandered and rejected by a very secular, self-centered, Jesus-hating world? Yes, there will be a lot of God's faithful people that will be vindicated for by God himself. This kind of faith is an enduring faith because it loves God more than anything else, even life itself. Every martyr had this kind of faith. Will he find faith on the earth? Martyrdom is a sign of that kind of faith. Folks, we're talking about a Hebrews 11 kind of faith. Have you read Hebrews 11 lately? Hebrews 11 is amazing. Just, I'm not going to read the whole chapter. We're going to read some passages in a minute, but by faith Abel, by faith Enoch, by faith Noah, by faith Abraham, by faith Isaac, by faith Jacob, by faith Joseph, by faith Moses' parents, by faith Moses, by faith God's people pass through the Red Sea on dry ground, and get this one, by faith the prostitute Rahab. A prostitute had faith? Yeah. The kind of faith we're talking about here. Now, I don't think she continues her practice, but that was her reputation. So don't worry about your past. Make a decision to follow Jesus. Your past, you don't have to worry about it. Because God knows. And that's all that matters, right? That's all that matters. And over time, our life will begin to show the fruit of a changed life. So all these people were mentioned, and some more. Let's go to Hebrews 11. Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to read the last part of the chapter. I mentioned all those names that were in the previous verses, but we're going to pick it up here with verse 32. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak. That's not Obama now. Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. Others were tortured and refused to be released so that they might gain a better resurrection. You can't tell me that life is smooth for a Christian. Never has been. Some faced jeers and flogging, while still others were chained and put in prison. They were stoned. They were sawed in two. They were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. Verse 38. The world was not worthy of them. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. the world is not worthy of them. The truth is, it's the end times. And the world as a whole isn't going to get any better. The world's not going to get any better, folks. The truth is, as they persecuted the prophets and saints of old, so shall we be. The truth is, the world we live in is getting darker every day. And guess what happens when it gets darker? Light gets more profound. You are the light of the world. The truth is, government and politics is a mess. But the truth is, don't miss this, God hasn't changed. Jesus and people's need for him hasn't changed. The power of the Holy Spirit hasn't changed. The Bible hasn't changed. So why have we become comfortable in Sodom? Accepting things. We need to be fighting the good fight. Voting is a part of that. But the greater part is living our lives for Jesus so that God receives the glory. We're not looking for pats on the back. In fact, if you live for Jesus, you'll get anything but a pat on the back. You may get a knife in the back. Boy, he's a downer today. I believe I'm speaking truth. Because that's what the Bible says in the end times, what's going to happen. And we're seeing it all around us. Let me give you some counsel. We need to get our heads out of the sand. We need to recognize what's going on. And we need to look at our own lives. Take an inventory. We've become way too comfortable in Sodom. Our faith that is solidly planted in Jesus Christ will show itself faithful and obedient no matter what conditions it finds itself in. No matter what conditions. It's a faith that shows up as persistent prayer, that asks and keeps on asking. It seeks and keeps on seeking. It knocks and keeps on knocking. A faith that is so focused on drawing close to God and bringing him glory so that it touches the very heart of God so much that we hear him saying, "The world's not worthy of you." What a compliment that would be. I mean, I like when it says, you know, someday God's going to say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Here's another one. The world's not worthy of you." God's saying, "You're not fitting in. And I'm proud of you for that. I'm proud of you for not fitting in. I've called you to be peculiar." Too many Christians are the same as the world. We're to be different and peculiar. Every time I read the news and I see another Christian with her head cut off, I'll put it in a cage and lower it into the water. I'll put in a cage and a fire lit under him. Think of that verse. The world's not worthy of them. Now what that said about me. I hope I don't have to be tortured. I'm not asking for that. But I am asking, and I'm working to get my faith so I'll be like that. The world's not worthy of people with this kind of faith. That's what Jesus is talking about. Will I find faith persistent, faith, tenacious faith, when I return, when I come back. This kind of faith is required today. And it's the kind of faith Jesus is asking about. And he wants us to answer his question. Here's the question, reworded for now. Jesus saying this, when I come back, will I find persistent, prayer-driven, obedient, never back down faith in you? When I come back, will I find persistent, prayer-driven, obedient, never back down kind of faith in you? And he's asking me, all of us, that question. Please stand with me. The Lord has called us to a high and holy calling. He hasn't called us to his side just so we can get home to heaven. That's happened, but that's a fruit of our faith. A future fruit. That's a future fruit, but we got some present fruit that needs to be showing right now. The present fruit looks like this. It's faithful. A faith that's faithful, a faith that's obedient, a faith that loves Jesus with nothing held back, a faith that says, whatever I'm going through, I'm going to make it because God's with me and he gives me the power and the authority to overcome anything. It's a kind of faith that doesn't give up. It's a kind of faith that prays and prays and prays and prays and prays. Prayer is one of the easiest things anybody can do, but it's amazing how little we do it often. I'm right there. I need to be doing more of it. But God has called us to people of prayer, people of faith, people that love Jesus. And I want to ask you tonight, listen to me. Do you know Jesus? I'm not talking about know about him. I'm not talking about reading a newspaper article about somebody. I heard their name. Do you have a personal relationship with the Lord of the universe through Jesus Christ? Can you say with all the confidence in you, I know Jesus, and when I die, I'm going to heaven. I don't have any doubt about that. Can you say that confidently today? It's the kind of faith that doesn't say, well, when my life is over, I hope I go to heaven. You can be assured of your place, of your relationship with Jesus. You can be assured of your place in heaven. You can be assured of your salvation without any worries. But you got to make that decision. It's a decision. The invitation has been given by Jesus, and he's waiting for our response. Every head bowed, every eye closed, please. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, we already had two recommitments this morning, by the way. Two recommitments to the Lord. But if you're here today and you've never received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, and you want to today, and you realize maybe for the first time that I got to get my life right with the Lord because I want to be strong for him and I want to have eternal life. If you have never done that, put your hand up. We want to pray with you. If you've never done that, you may want to make a commitment to Jesus Christ for the very first time. That's what we're talking about right now. Very first time. You've never done that, that you know about, that you remember. Anybody? Put your hand up and we'll pray with you. In that case, all of us in here are Christian. And that means that we need to be people of prayer. That means God is asking us, will he find faith when he returns? Faith in us? Is there anybody here who wants to recommit their life to Christ? They want to resubmit to him. Just kind of get back into walking every step, every day as Jesus as your Savior and Lord.
and you recognize that maybe you want to walk closer to Him, put your hand up and we'll pray with you. Pray with you. I see that hand. Recommitment, resubmission. I see that hand. Let's all pray this prayer together. I invite you to. Lord Jesus, I thank you for loving me. I thank you placed inside of me a faith that I need to use. I need to invest my faith in the right thing. And I invest it in you. Forgive me of all my sins. I recommit my life to you. I am sold out to you now. From now on, help me to walk every day in the power of your Spirit in obedience. I want to have the kind of faith that you look at me and you say, you have that kind of faith that I talked about in Luke 18. Thank you, God, for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's sing and give God glory. If you need to do business with God, just do it. Don't let this opportunity miss you. Jesus.
Your great grace. Into eternity, your grace finds me. Yes, your grace finds me. There on the wedding day, there in the wind and by the graveside.
Your grace.